Welcome to another study in discipleship. We're dealing with the absolutes of discipleship. Jesus makes absolute demands upon his disciples. And we said, first of all, his demand is set forth in Matthew 16:24, "Let a man deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." Now, the denial of self is the denial of the self-centered life. We're to choose the cross, and the cross is something that we are to willfully choose and pick up and carry. The cross is something you deliberately and voluntarily choose to carry every day. It's the daily crucifixion of the life of self-interest, is choosing in every situation what's best, not for us, but for the kingdom of God. In all our decisions and choices, we're to ask ourselves, what would Jesus have me to choose? What is my motivation in doing this or that? Is it for God's glory or my welfare? It's choosing to do God's will regardless of the consequences. That's the cross. Then he says, they are to follow me. We're not to follow religious programs or man or doctrines or institution or religion, but to follow Jesus. And you will find the direction that Jesus is headed and the direction that institutional religion is headed, these directions are opposites. They're contrary one to another. That's why Jesus insists that you follow him. Are you following Jesus or some religious system? Now, you can answer that for yourself, my friend, but to be a disciple of Jesus, we must walk in his steps. 1 Peter 2. And then the third absolute of discipleship, he said that we must suffer trials as the means of obtaining the kingdom. Acts 14:22, we must by much tribulation enter the kingdom of God. As we said in the last message, we are not to look upon trials as things to be avoided at all costs, but the way into the kingdom. If you're not suffering trial and persecution and tribulation for the gospel's sake, for your testimony's sake, for righteousness' sake, for Jesus' sake, then you're on the wrong pathway. We must enter the kingdom by the pathway that God has established and ordained, and that's the way of trial and tribulation for righteousness' sake. Now, fourthly, the absolute of discipleship to Jesus requires total commitment and permanent commitment. Luke 9:62. See if this isn't total commitment. He that has put his hand to the plow and looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. Now that speaks of total commitment and permanent commitment. Whenever you begin to set forth Jesus' terms concerning what he requires of his disciples as distinguished from what the denominations require of church members, you'll begin to see why Jesus always dealt in absolutes. Because his word was designed to separate true disciples from professing Christians and mere church members. His strong word has a way of doing just that. As soon as you begin to teach on the end-time message of faith and the deeper life in the Spirit and on true New Testament discipleship, then you'll see that his would-be disciples will begin to hedge and back away. You see this all through the New Testament. In John 6, when he set forth that strong teaching on the doctrine of election, then his disciples left him and walked no more with him. Strong teaching concerning the absolutes of discipleship have the same reaction. We see this in Luke chapter 9, for example. And this is why a lot of professing Christians who've never been born again, who fill up the pews on Sunday morning, can go home in peace and contentment, because they're never challenged with anything stronger than just a sermonette most of the time. They're never told to take up a cross. If they are, taking up a cross in denominational thinking is to help bear the financial burdens of the church. Sacrificing your life means to sacrifice some of your time in a visitation program. Dedicating your life to God's service is doing the denomination's service. I preached on Luke chapter 9 and Luke chapter 14 in the First Baptist Church in one city in which I was a pastor years ago until they literally gnashed their teeth upon me and tried to fire me, simply because I was setting forth what you're hearing in these broadcasts. Now, there were three would-be disciples set forth in Luke chapter 9 that Jesus dealt with, and he didn't pamper a single one of the three. And if they had been like many today, he would have lost all three prospects. People today just can't seem to get it through their heads. There's not a verse in the Bible that says God's trying to fill up heaven with as many people as he can. No, he demands quality before quantity. And you'll see that in the Word if you'll be honest with yourself. Jesus was constantly teaching and saying things that separated between would-be disciples, true disciples, and mere hangers-on who wanted the loaves and fishes. Read the New Testament and you'll see that again and again. Jesus never tried to make disciples at any cost. He made disciples who would pay the cost. Jesus dampened the spirit of that first would-be disciple in Luke 9 by telling him, "Now you better find out where I'm going before you say you want to follow me wherever I go. I'm not going to a coronation as a king, but to the cross." In Luke 9, 57 and 58, the would-be disciple said, "Lord, I'll follow thee whithersoever thou goest." Now that's a mouthful, my friends. To say you'll follow Jesus wherever he goes, you better find out where he's going. He's always going to the cross. That's why he says, "Deny yourself and take up your cross and follow him." Jesus said, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." Jesus knew that enthusiasm and endurance are not the same things. Oh, a lot of people have enthusiasm. I've had people say to me, "I'll not be like those you speak of who wouldn't receive this strong message. I'll be an overcomer. I'll stay with you." A man said that to me, and he said, "Oh, I'll be an overcomer. I'll not be like those people. I'll be the last to leave." Why, he lasted about 6 months. Another young man said, "I'll never leave." He said, "I'll never stumble. I'll never fall away. If everybody in the church does, I'll not." Why, he was the first to fall away. This is why Jesus commands you and Luke 9 and Luke chapter 14 to count the cost first. Are you saying that you are going to follow Jesus wherever he goes? You better find out where he's going, my friend, because you may not want to pay the cost to go where he's going. He's going to the cross. That's why he says, "Deny the self-life, take up your cross and follow me." Now, if you ask, "Brother Freeman, are you saying the people who don't endure the strong message you preach about discipleship as Jesus demands it, that maybe they're not saved?" Oh, I didn't have to say that. Jesus already did. He said the ones that endure to the end will be saved. He's saying the ones that take up the cross and follow him will be saved. If people come into our meetings and accept with their heads the message of discipleship and not their heart, and then later turn away or resist or reject the word, yes, I promptly tell them what Jesus said to tell them in Luke 9:62, and I tell them it applies to them. "He that puts his hand to the plow and looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God." Jesus said, "He that endures to the end will be saved." Not he that endures as much as he can, and then like a hog goes back into the mire of man's creeds and institutional religion, or plays God and stays home and says, "Well, I'm all right the way I am. I'm satisfied with myself. I can get my revelations here just as well as church, and I don't have to listen to all that hard teaching on discipleship." Yes, it is hard, it's stern, but I didn't invent it. I'm just quoting to you what Jesus said. And if you want to make it into the kingdom, my friend, I would suggest that you find out what he said and follow in his path. Because Jesus said, "In that day many are going to cry, 'Lord, Lord,' but he says, 'I don't know you.' Many will say, 'Lord, Lord,' but he says, 'It's not everyone that calls me Jesus or says he believes in me or calls me Lord that will enter the kingdom of God, but only he that does the will of my Father which is in heaven.' You should lay aside all else and find out if what we tell you is from the Word of God, and you will find if you check it out it is, and then you can do the will of God. You should find out whether or not what we're saying is God's will, because your spiritual future depends upon it, my friends. Get into the Word of God and you'll find we're quoting it to you time and again. Jesus never pampered people like the churches do today and allows them to join something and get dipped in water or sprinkled and then feel like they're safe and on the road to heaven simply because they come for an hour or two as spectators and listen to sermons. No, disciples of Jesus are the only ones who are saved, and disciples of Jesus are those who deny the self-life, take up the cross, and follow him. And now what Jesus said to the other two would-be disciples in Luke 9 illustrate that we must make total commitment, permanent commitment, and immediate commitment. In verse 59 of Luke 9, he said to another, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, allow me first to go bury my father." Allow me first. How often people say, "Oh, I'll follow you, Jesus, but allow me first to get all of my important things done." Now, what's the trouble here? Well, this man had some unattended business. And you say, but wasn't that important business, burying his dead father? Important to whom, my friend? To God or the would-be disciple? Apparently, God didn't think it was as important as following Jesus. Most Christians miss the whole point when they talk that way. The Son of God is saying, by giving this extreme example in Luke 9:59, whatever it is that you believe is important, even in the case of the death of a loved one, when I say go speak, go witness, go do this or that, then nothing else is important. Absolutely nothing else is important, or I would have told you to take care of that first. Then in Luke 9:60, he said, "Let the dead bury their dead, but go thou and preach the kingdom of God." Not bury your father. Not even stay around for the funeral, but what would people think of me? Well, you know what they would think, and you know what they would say about you, and that's precisely why Jesus makes such absolute demands upon his disciples. He knows the tendency of human nature to put some important things before him and his will in your life. Important? Yes, burying a loved one who has died or showing respect for the dead is important, but obeying God and preaching to the living, he says, is much more important. You've got to see that, friend, or you cannot be a disciple of Jesus. You say, have you ever experienced such things? I certainly have, when I've had to make the choice between preaching the kingdom and teaching the word and taking care of mine own interests. Or I know of cases of others, a missionary whose father died, and he was ready to sail for the mission field. And he said to me, I had to choose between going back and burying my father or keeping my face headed in the direction that God had sent me. He said, I made the choice. I made a telephone call and gave my condolences to the family and turned my back on my dead father and went to preach to the living. Do you get the message? Oh, so many in the churches can't pay that cost, and it only proves they're not disciples of Jesus. Whatever it is that takes to test your faith and your loyalty to Jesus Christ, you can be sure he's going to allow it. You're going to have to pass the test on that one thing before you can go higher, before you'll ever be sure you're a true disciple of Jesus. It may be a financial trial, the loss of a job, the loss of your business, the loss of some profits to prove you're loyal to Jesus. The rich young ruler proved that he could not give up his riches to take up the cross and follow Jesus. It may be a personal trial. You may need to finish college or get a career well established first, but he's going to require you put him first. It may be a marital trial where you are having difficulty submitting to your role as a husband or wife, but you're going to have to do that before you can go higher. It may be you can't put Christ first before your wife or husband or child, but you're going to have to overcome that before you can be a disciple of Jesus. It may be a mental trial. You don't like the thought of being ridiculed or laughed at by denominational church members because you have the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Well, whatever it is, my friends, you must pay the cost to follow Jesus.